till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse through the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more.
I got the horses in the back, horse stock is attached. Head is matted black, got the boosters black to match. Riding on a horse, you can whip your Porsche. I've been in the valley, you can't nobody tell me.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Wild Sports Talk. This is a very special Wild Sports Talk as we are doing the 2021-2022 NBA Preview Special. We have a lot to talk about there, and of course, my name is Loro Antonio, and with me is the Asian Skip Bayless. Isaiah Leong, Adam Barber has the night off, and we'll see him maybe again. We'll see him on the show again on Friday or something like that. So, Isaiah, how are you doing, my friend?
I'm doing great, Loro. It's great to be back on Wild Sports Talk. I know we didn't have a show on Friday because, you know, you were calling ColorCast, and I was busy, and Adam was busy as well. It's great to be back doing WST. The NBA season officially is about what? Less than
24 hours away.
Exactly, 24 hours away. By this time tomorrow night, the Lakers will be playing, probably be playing in either the third or midway in the fourth quarter. So that's very exciting. I'm just so happy that, you know, basketball is back, because I think the Lakers are going to have a tremendous season this year with Russ, LeBron, and AD. You know, finally have a big three now in Los Angeles. We haven't had a big three since it was Dwight Howard, Steve Nash, and Kobe Bryant. So very exciting times ahead for the Lakers and many other teams in the NBA. It's just so great to see, you know, basketball finally back after a long, long wait.
It has been a long wait, and it's now back to the normal calendar after with all the situation with COVID and all that. Looking forward to talking about some basketball here. So let's start with the Western Conference divisions, and let's start with the Pacific Division. You got the LA Lakers, you got the LA Clippers, the Sacramento Kings, the Phoenix Suns, and the Golden State Warriors. My pick to win the Pacific Division, I think it's going to be the Lakers that's going to win that division. I think the Suns will finish in second, and I think that the Clippers will finish in third in that division. And all three of those teams are going to make the playoffs.
Yeah, I agree with you. The Lakers are going to win that division. I think that right now in the division that they're – just the strongest team in that division. You know, they got Russell Westbrook, they got LeBron James, they got Anthony Davis, they got a big three now in Los Angeles. And I like what they did to reinforce the bench. You know, the bench, you got a lot of 3-and-D players like Wayne Ellington, Malik Monk, Kendrick Nunn, who I think was a really underrated addition for the Los Angeles Lakers. You also got Austin Reaves, the young rookie who I've been really high on this preseason. You know, he can shoot the three, he can get to the rim, he can shoot the mid-range, extremely effective. He is also a really good defender as well. So I think, you know, the 3-and-D players, I like what they are doing on the bench. And then you got the big man, Dwight Howard's coming back. He's going to give you great energy. He's going to be a dominant force in the paint when it comes to rebounding and blocking shots. And then when Dwight Howard sits down, you got DeAndre Jordan as well to come in and replace him. So you don't basically lose anything from a dominant force in the paint when it comes to rebounding and blocking shots and throwing down alley-oops. So I think the Lakers are a really strong and deep team. I think they're definitely going to be number one in this division. The Suns, I think it's going to be the Suns and the Warriors to battle it out for second place, because I like the Suns, Devin Booker, Chris Paul, but are they going to be hung over after the NBA Finals loss? That's a question that's really lingering in my head. Plus, you know, outside of Chris Paul, this roster is a really young roster. So how are they going to bounce back from a really devastating loss in the NBA Finals to the Milwaukee Bucks? The Warriors, you know, Curry's there. Jordan Poole, who I think is going to have a big season. You have Klay Thompson coming back. Draymond Green. I think the Warriors will definitely be back to being a top team in the Western Conference. And then for me, the Clippers is going to be after the Lakers, the Suns, and the Warriors, just because I think that Paul George, he's a great basketball player, but and they have Eric Bledsoe as well, who I don't know if you should count on him to produce on a night in and night out basis. But Kawhi Leonard is going to be out probably until the playoffs, or he might not even play this year. So that's a big loss for them, both on the offensive end and the defensive end, because when Kawhi's there, you can't just leave Kawhi with all the attention. You have to, you know, give Paul George the attention. You have to give Kawhi the attention. You have to spread it out when it comes to defensive attention. And I just think that with Kawhi being out, all the attention will be on Paul George. He's going to be double teamed and triple teamed like crazy. And I just don't know if the Clippers supporting cast will be able to lift them to be competitive in the Western Conference. And then the Kings are definitely going to be last, because I just don't know what the Kings' direction is. I think that Luke Walton, I really liked Luke Walton when he was with the Lakers. I thought that, you know, he was unfairly fired, but I don't know why the Kings keep keeping him, because it just doesn't make any sense. You know, he's a good offensive coach, but you need to play some sort of defense to win in the NBA, and the Kings have been one of the worst defensive teams for the last 3 years under Luke Walton. So I think the Kings are going to be last, and I would not be shocked if Luke Walton gets fired midseason.
Yeah, we'll have to talk about that, about who's going to get fired first. But I'm going to add to the Warriors part what you said. I think the Warriors, I'm not going to count them out as long as Steph Curry's healthy. I think when they get Klay Thompson back, I think they're going to be competitive in the Western Conference. And then the Suns, you said it right there. It's going to depend on what are you going to get from the Phoenix Suns. Are they going to be hung over from that NBA Finals loss to the Bucks, or are they going to turn it around? I think the Suns are going to definitely turn it around, just because I think that they re-signed Chris Paul. This team has unfinished business, and I think Chris Paul can finally win a ring with Phoenix. I certainly think he can get the Suns a ring, but it's going to depend on if the Suns can stay healthy throughout the season. Are they going to be consistent on defense? Because they did not even give DeAndre Ayton an extension. But maybe they give him a max contract if he plays up to expectations this season. So that's another subject to talk about here.
And Laurel, I want to add one last thing before we move on to the next division, is the Phoenix Suns are now going to be one of the hunted teams in the NBA. They're no longer going to be able to be a team that just surprises everybody out of nowhere, just like they were last season. So how are they going to feel, and how are they going to respond now being the hunted in the NBA as opposed to being the hunter? We saw what happened with the Golden State Warriors from when they were first beginning their run with Steph Curry and Draymond Green and Klay Thompson. They surprised everybody. Then the next year, they took a step back because they weren't used to every team playing their best game against them whenever they played the Golden State Warriors, because they were the team that everybody – or not everybody, but people – I had already taken notice, and we're like, yeah, they are a for real team, and we want to hunt them down. So how are the Suns going to respond to now being the hunted as opposed to the hunter?
Yeah, and I want to add something to the Kings here. I mean, like you said, Isaiah, I agree that they're a great offensive team with De'Aaron Fox, Marvin Bagley, Buddy Hield. Defensively, they give up a lot of points. And Luke Walton, I think he's a great coach for young players to develop young talent. But you gotta play defense to win a championship. And if, unlike you said, he might get fired midseason, but we'll have to wait and see. Because the Kings, I don't know what direction they're in. They're a dysfunctional organization that doesn't know what they're doing.
Exactly. They are a dysfunctional organization. And I also don't understand what they're doing when it comes to drafting and when it comes to free agency. You didn't need that many guards because you already had Tyrese Halliburton, who is a stud, and you had a De'Aaron Fox as well. And they go out there and draft a guard. So I don't know what the Kings are doing. I think that Luke Walton, I think he's going to be out either midseason or he's going to be out after this season. But I think this is his last year in Sacramento.
Yep, this is his last chance. Now let's talk about the Southwest Division. You got the Houston Rockets, who are also dysfunctional. You got the Spurs. They're in there. They're always there. They're always in that race for the Western Conference playoffs. But they're not really a top team in the West just because their roster isn't built enough yet. They're in rebuild mode. The New Orleans Pelicans, what direction are they going to go in? Is Zion going to take that next leap? Are the Pelicans going to be contenders in the West with Zion? And do you think that Willie Green is going to be the head coach that Zion can really relate to? Because Stan Van Gundy was not the right head coach for the Pelicans. I just thought that the Pelicans didn't even play hard for him. Stan Van Gundy only wanted to run the team and coach the team his own way, but it never worked out. The Memphis Grizzlies, they're rising. They're going to be very, very good in the next few years. Don't be shocked that maybe this year, maybe the year after, that they're going to be in the top three or top four in the West with Ja Morant, because he can really help the Grizzlies get them a championship. And the Dallas Mavericks. I really think that this team, they don't want to play the Clippers again. I think that Luka Doncic and Kristaps Porzingis, I think they're still going to be a competitive team out there. And I think Jason Kidd is going to do a really, really good job coaching this group.
Yeah, for me, Loro, I got to go with the Dallas Mavericks. I think the Dallas Mavericks win this division just because, like you said, out of all these teams, they look like the team that has the most stability, and they look like the team that really has the most talent out of everybody in the Southwest Division. You look at the Houston Rockets. I like Houston. I like where they're going, but they're rebuilding. They're a really young team. I think Jalen Green, watch out for him in the Rookie of the Year race, because I watched this dude play in the G League last year. He is an absolute monster. He's going to be sensational as a young rookie. And then you look at the Spurs. Loro, I think the Spurs are like the Kings, but they have a way, way better coach. And what I mean by that is the Spurs, they don't know what direction they want to be in. Yes, they have these young talent, but then you go out and get Doug McDermott, and I believe they got someone else in free agency. So do the Spurs want to contend, or do they want to rebuild? Like, and the Spurs have been doing that for the past like three seasons. You know, they traded away Kawhi Leonard. I thought they were going to do it to try to get some young players so they can expedite the rebuild, but no, they traded him for Jacob Poto and also DeMar DeRozan, and you're just thinking, like, what are you doing? Are you trying to win? Because they're certainly not good enough to win a championship, but they are either they're just trying to fight to get to like the ninth or the 10th seed in the playoffs. That's what the Spurs ceiling is. They're not that bad to be a rebuilding team, but they're not that good to contend in the Western Conference. So the Spurs are just in that middle tier that you just never want to be. The Pelicans, like you said, Loro, I think Willie Green is going to do a good job with the Pelicans. I really like that hire because he played in the NBA. He relates to the players way better than Stan Van Gundy was when he was the Pelicans head coach. And also, you know, the Pelicans, Zion, I think that I don't know if he's going to take another step because he's already injured, for goodness sakes. But I think the player to watch out for is Brandon Ingram. You know, this kid has been going up and up and up ever since he got to New Orleans. And I think he will take that next step and continue to be on the path of being a superstar in the NBA. And I think that with Willie Green, I think you're going to see in the locker room, they're going to have more stability there instead of having so much chaos and turmoil just because Willie Green played in the NBA. He coached, you know, the Phoenix Suns, who had great chemistry. He knows what great locker rooms look like. So I think just having that will give the Pelicans a jolt of energy. The Grizzlies, you're right. Ja Morant is a stud. He's a future superstar. But, Loro, I'm worried about the Grizzlies because they did lose a lot in the offseason. You know, I believe I'm forgetting who they lost off the top of my head, but they lost a lot of really good players. And I don't know what they were kind of doing, especially late in the offseason. So I got to go with Dallas. I just think that Dallas, Luka, you know, one of the best players already in basketball, Jason Kidd, I think that's what they needed. They needed a new voice because, you know, no disrespect to Rick Carlisle. He's a great coach, and I think he's going to do great things in Indiana. But I just think when you're in a place for 10 years, 10 plus years, your voice starts to get stale. You know, people start getting tired of listening to your voice and, you know, following you. So I think a new voice was definitely needed. And I think that, you know, having a new voice both in the front office and and as a head coach in Jason Kidd, I think will do wonders for the Dallas Mavericks. And I think that they will finally take that next step and actually go to the second round or more in the playoffs in the Western Conference. So I definitely got to go with Dallas.
I'm going to go with the Dallas Mavericks, too. I think the Dallas Mavericks are a team that I know Jason Kidd from his days with the Lakers, and I know that he is a great offensive innovator. He's really good running the offense, And I really think that Luka Doncic and Kristaps Porzingis are going to thrive in Jason Kidd's offensive system. Even though that in his first two tries as a head coach with the Nets and also the Bucks, it didn't go the way he wanted. I think Jason Kidd is coming into the right situation, and I think that he is going to do a fantastic job coaching the Dallas Mavericks. And I have to agree with you about Willie Green, because Willie Green, he knows what it's like being in a locker room. He's played in the NBA for a long, long time, and I think that he's going to do a way better job in New Orleans than Stan Van Gundy has. So we have a comment from Christy Wilson, and she says, "Hi, guys." And she also has a question for us. Do you see the Milwaukee Bucks repeating as NBA champions? I'm going to go first. I'm going to say absolutely. Since they were the defending champs last year, I think this year they're going to be in contention for playing in the NBA Finals again. I just think that the Milwaukee Bucks, they're on the rise, and I think that this team is ready to win now and into the future. Isaiah, can you relate to this question?
I think they are going to be in contention, but Christy, unfortunately, I don't see them repeating as NBA champions just because I think the Lakers got much better with adding Russell Westbrook to their team, adding Carmelo Anthony, who I think was an underrated addition to the Los Angeles Lakers, and they got better in the offseason. And then you look at the Miami Heat, and Laura, we're going to talk about the Heat later on, but I am really high on the Miami Heat. I love what they did adding Kyle Lowry. I think that was the second star that they needed to pair next to Jimmy Butler. Now you have Lowry, you have Tyler Hero, who looked really good in the preseason, scoring like 20 points every single game. They brought back Duncan Robinson. You do have Bam Adebayo. Watch out for Miami. I think Miami is a team that everybody is sleeping on right now in the Eastern Conference, because everybody's talking about the Nets, talking about the Bucks, talking about the Atlanta Hawks, but watch out for Miami. I think they're going to be great defensively because Lowry and Jimmy Butler are dogs when it comes to the defensive side of the ball. Don't forget about Bam Adebayo, but also they can score the basketball as well. And if you have Duncan Robinson and Tyler Hero finally being back to what they were during the bubble, then, wow, the Miami Heat are definitely going to be a force to be reckoned with.
I agree with that. We're going to talk about the Miami Heat in just a little bit. Now let's talk about the Northwest Division. You got the Denver Nuggets. I really think that when, with or without Jamal Murray, this team is very underrated. With Nikola Jokic, Michael Porter Jr., who just got a max contract. I like Will Barton. He's really good defensively and also driving into the hoop. And also Malik Andrews. Malik Morris, he is also a really good sixth man. And for the Blazers, Damian Lillard, CJ McCollum, I think Chauncey Billups is going to do a really, really good job coaching this Blazers team and relating to Damian Lillard and CJ McCollum and making them better guards, because Chauncey Billups used to be a point guard in the NBA. And I think that Chauncey Billups will really teach them what it means to play these type of positions. And then the Utah Jazz, I love that roster. I think that the Utah Jazz with Rudy Gobert, Donovan Mitchell, and Mike Conley, they make a great team, a great tandem, I meant. And I think that the Utah Jazz, they're going to be a team that is going to be very competitive. They might be top six in the West or maybe a play-in kind of team. But I think that with the West so tough, the Utah Jazz, I expect them to have a very, very good season. And for Stephen Wang, the Minnesota Timberwolves. I'm sorry to tell you this, Stephen, if you're watching this, the Timberwolves have talent. I mean, they have guys like Karl Anthony Towns, Anthony Edwards. I think those are their two best players, and then D'Angelo Russell. But I think the Timberwolves are probably going to be one of the worst teams in the NBA yet again. Or maybe they might surprise a lot of people since they got Patrick Beverley. But this is a very, very young team. But I don't see the Timberwolves going anywhere with the roster that they have. And, of course, the Oklahoma City Thunder. I love Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. I think they have a very good young roster. I think Sam Presti's done a really good job rebuilding this roster. But I just don't think they're there just yet. So I give me the Denver Nuggets to win the Northwest Division.
Yeah, for me, I'm going to go with the Denver Nuggets as well. And that's because, you know, I think that even without Jamal Murray for, I believe, Laurel, correct me if I'm wrong, is Jamal Murray going to be out for the entire season, or is he going to be back sometime during the season, like during the latter parts of the season?
He should be back at some point this season.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, I think that right now, I think that the Denver Nuggets are the best team because I think that Jamal Murray, he's going to be gone, but he'll be back sometime later on in the season. But this gives Michael Porter Jr., who is oozing with talent, an opportunity, a golden opportunity to be that player that everybody expected when he came out in the 2017 NBA draft. I might be wrong on that, but you know, he got a big contract and he's got to live up to that now that he got a big contract there in the Mile High City. And don't forget, you got Jokic, who is a monster. You got other players there as well that can shoot the basketball outside of Jokic. So I think that the Nuggets, you know, who play good defense, they're a team that, you know, everybody knows the role in Denver. I just think that right now, when it comes to the Denver Nuggets, I just think out of that division, it's going to be Nuggets. I think it's going to be Nuggets versus Jazz for this division. I just think the Nuggets are the better team. The Trailblazers, Loro, I like the Trailblazers, but, you know, the Trailblazers are good. Like, they have great talent with McCollum and with Lillard. But Chauncey Billups, he's a rookie head coach. I know he's going to be well-respected. My only issue, though, is the Trailblazers, they can shoot the lights out of the basketball. But can they play defense? You know, that's what's been hindering the Trailblazers from taking that next step when it comes to this franchise, is they don't play defense. They're always, like, either last or second to last in the NBA when it comes to defensive ratings. So if Portland wants to take that next step, they need to be able to play competent defense, and also they need to be able to rely on other players, not just McCollum and Lillard on the offensive side of the ball. So if they can do that, I think they will be able to definitely be in this Western Conference race. Oklahoma City Thunder, I like Shai Gilgeous-Alexander. I think their coach, Mark Dagnott, is doing a great job developing the young players, but I just think that the Thunder, they're I would say about 4 to 5 years away from actually contending for a playoff spot in the West. And then, you know, Minnesota. I think Minnesota, D'Angelo Russell, the big question with Minnesota is injuries. It's injuries. You know, like, they have the talent with Russell and Towns, and you expect them without those two guys to be able to compete for a playoff spot. Maybe not like a top five playoff spot, but like one of those, either a play-in tournament spot or one of the final playoff spots in the West. But they're always hurt. Like, it's every season they're always hurt. So if they can fight off the injury bug, they may be able to make some noise. But from the injuries to what happened in the front office, from the president of basketball ops guy getting fired because he had an affair with an assistant, there's just so much turmoil around this team. And I just don't know what direction the Minnesota Timberwolves really want to go, because there's reports that, you know, they might trade Russell, and then there's other reports that they might go get Ben Simmons to pair with Towns and Russell and try to go for it. So I don't know what the Timberwolves want to do, but the first step they need to take is to fight off that injury bug. But I'm definitely going with the Nuggets.
Yeah, the Timberwolves, they definitely have to fight off the injury bug. You're not saying that the Timberwolves are dysfunctional, though.
No, I'm not saying they're dysfunctional when it comes to the locker room, but, you know, the front office is definitely dysfunctional because, you know, you had a guy that got fired after, you know, he had an affair with an assistant, and there was a lot of fighting in that front office. But the players, they got talent. They have talent. It's just a matter of, are they going to stay healthy? Because, like, Loro, you know this. You know, the Lakers, they had a lot of talent last year, but the reason why they lost in the first round, because LeBron was there, but AD was hurt. And a lot of the other players were hurt too. So your best ability is your availability. And Minnesota, they just can't stay healthy.
They just can't stay healthy. And I want to add a point here that the Lakers got Avery Bradley back to fill that roster spot. And I really, really think that this was a fantastic pickup to bring Avery Bradley back to the Lakers. I think he has unfinished business.
Love the pickup. I love the pickup, Loro, because Avery Bradley's going to be able to fill in for Trevor Ariza and THT while those two guys recover from their injuries. But my only issue, though, is What about Austin Reaves? Give the kid a chance. He played great during the preseason. He was great defensively. He was great at shooting the basketball. Give the kid a chance. Look at Caruso. You gave him a chance, and he was a guy that nobody even thought about when he came into the NBA. You gave him a chance, and he shined. Maybe Austin Reaves can do the same thing, but it's a good pickup for the Lakers to get Avery Bradley.
Yes, and then also Christy Wilson wanted to say, the Nuggets looked like they could be on the team on the rise. I absolutely agree with that. And then Jared Peterson also wanted to say hello as well. So now let's talk about let's move on to the Eastern Conference. You got the Atlantic Division. It's a fun division to talk about. So you got the Boston Celtics, the Brooklyn Nets, the Toronto Raptors, the New York Knicks, and the Philadelphia 76ers. Let me start with the Celtics first. I mean, I feel like that when Danny Ainge stepped down, he gave the president of basketball operations job to Brad Stevens to succeed him. And look what Brad Stevens has done to that roster. I really think that it's the roster that Brad Stevens would envision it because he likes Al Horford. I love that he got Al Horford back. Kemba Walker, good thing. I think the Celtics are going to be better off without Kemba Walker because you got Jason Tatum. Jaylen Brown is a fantastic scorer. He's really good in transition, really good defensively, and he can really give you steals, and he can give you put-back dunks and all that. I really think that the Boston Celtics are going to be they're going to be even better than they were this last season, and don't sleep on the Boston Celtics being in that top six in the East because I really think that this team is very talented. And I really think that the Celtics are going to build their team around Jason Tatum, who I think the Celtics are going to have their next winning franchise with Jason Tatum. And the Brooklyn Nets, you talk about they're kind of built the same way like the Lakers, but they use a lot of small ball because Steve Nash likes using that because he's come from the Mike D'Antoni system. I think that if Kyrie does not play this season, I still have the Nets winning the Eastern Conference. I really think with Harden, with KD, and with Blake Griffin, that is still enough for the Nets here. And for the Raptors, I think now that you don't have Kyle Lowry anymore, I really think that they're going to build this team the right way with Pascal Siakam and Fred VanVleet because Masai Ujiri knows what he's doing. But the Raptors are in somewhat of a rebuild mode, but I really think that building their team around Pascal Siakam and Fred VanVleet is really the way to go for the Toronto Raptors. For the New York Knicks, I think this team, nobody thought that they would be this good last year. And nobody thought that they would be in the top five in the Eastern Conference. And I didn't even think they would be in this position. I think the Knicks, to me, they're a playoff team. I really think that if they recruit better players to build around RJ Barrett, I really think that the Knicks could really, really be championship contenders. This team is going in the right direction with Coach Thibodeau. James Dolan James Dolan is such a bad owner. Fans don't love him. Players didn't want to play for the Knicks because of James Dolan. But I think Tom Thibodeau is wanting to make that recruit like, oh, I want superstars to play for the Knicks so that the Knicks and Nets could be a rivalry. And for the 76ers, you still got Ben Simmons. You still got Joel Embiid. I still think that the Sixers can win and can contend for a championship with Ben Simmons, which I agree with Doc Rivers said, but I think the Brooklyn Nets are going to win the Atlantic Division.
Sorry about that. I was on mute. But, Low Roll, I agree. I got the Nets winning the division just because, you know, I think the Celtics – I'm not a really big fan of what the Celtics did, honestly. I know, you know, Danny Ainge stepped down. I think that was good because, like I said with – I believe it was the Mavericks, that when you have someone at their job for 10-plus years, and they're doing a great job. No disrespect to Danny Ainge. He was doing a phenomenal job. He did a phenomenal job with the Celtics. But when you have a guy that's been there for so long, a new voice would be good for that organization. That's why I think that Brad Stevens moving up is a good thing because it allowed a new voice and Ime Udoka to be there in the locker room. Though I didn't like the hire of Ime Udoka. I think they should have gotten Rick Carlisle from who was available after he resigned from the Dallas Mavericks just because Ime Udoka is a first-year head coach. Now you have – there's a lot of theories out there, Loro, that who's really coaching the team? Is it like, you know, a MLB situation where you have the front office pulling the strings from above? Is Ime Udoka a puppet? We don't know. You know, it could be Brad Stevens calling the shots from the front office and Ime Udoka just following orders. So that's why I didn't really like the hire. I thought that the Celtics, they needed to get a head coach that was established and a strong voice, a no-nonsense type of guy as the head coach. And I think that would have been great for the Boston Celtics, because that's what they needed. The Boston Celtics did not have any order. They didn't have any structure. They didn't have any discipline last year. There was just so much chaos. And a rookie coach, as good as Ime Udoka might be for the Boston Celtics, he's not going to be ready right now to clean up the mess that happened in the locker room. And I think that Rick Carlisle would have been the guy to be able to clean that up. But having said that, you know, Tatum's going to be great. Brown's going to be great, you know, coming back from injury. Al Horford, I know they got him from Oklahoma City, I believe. But, you know, the Celtics are trying to do what LSU did, and that is run it back to the glory days. And, Al Horford, you know, he's years removed from that. Like, is he going to be the same player that he was, you know, a stud in Boston before he went – before he went to the Philadelphia 76ers. We don't really know that. There's a lot of questions with this team. So I'm not really as high as the Celtics on as you are, Loro. I have them, honestly, right now, I believe, in the eighth spot in my playoff predictions. I think the Celtics will be – they'll be fine, but I just think there's too many questions. And I think what the Boston Celtics are lacking is – Tatum's great. He's a star. You know, they also have – Brown, he's a star. I think they need that one more star to be able to actually compete with some of those top teams that we have named in the NBA. And watch out for Peyton Pritchard, Loro. Watch out for him. This dude was a rookie last year out of Oregon. He averaged 7 points per game, 2 rebounds a game, 1 assist per game. Numbers weren't great, but he's a year removed. He had a great preseason. I think he's going to take that next step and actually be good this year for the Boston Celtics, so watch out for him. As far as the other teams are concerned, Raptors are rebuilding. I didn't really like their first-round pick. I don't know, you know, what they're doing. Pascal Siakam, he's got to show that he is a star. He's got to be more consistent for the Toronto Raptors. The Sixers, you know, Joel Embiid is great. Tobias Harris is a good player. But I think that missing Ben Simmons is really going to hurt the Sixers a lot, just because he's a valuable defender for the Sixers. And now the guy that's replacing him, he's not that good of a defender. So they lose a lot on the defensive side and also on the playmaking side on offense. So that, I think it's Mike Scott that's replacing him. Mike Scott's really going to have to step his game up to replace Ben Simmons, because Ben Simmons, I don't know if he's even going to play, because I know that they reached an agreement for him to come back to training camp, but all indications are that he's going to sit out until a trade is there and just practice with the team. So he would be like Kyrie. The Knicks, I agree with Jared Peterson. You know, Loro, if we could pull up Jared's comment, last comment, that would be great. You know, Jared says, I got the Knicks taking a step back, and I think they really overachieved last year. I think it's the same thing. I think the Knicks really overachieved. They're like the Phoenix Suns. They're going to go from being the hunter now to being the hunted in the Eastern Conference. So how are they going to respond to that? We don't know. And, you know, RJ Barrett's a good player. Randall, you know, he was inconsistent prior to last year. Teams are going to have film on him. They know how to guard him better now. Just look what the Atlanta Hawks did to him in the postseason. They got Kemba Walker, but, you know, he can't stay healthy. That's not his problem. He just can't stay healthy. So if he's healthy, if Randall can figure it out and avoid a slump year, I think they will be fine, but I just think they'll take a step back because I think the East is really good, and also because I think that they really overachieved last year. And, you know, the other team is the Nets. I think the Nets, KD, Harden, they're in a class of their own. Missing Kyrie, I think, will hurt, but it won't hurt their chances of winning this division, just because the Celtics have a lot of questions. Raptors are rebuilding. Knicks, I expect to take a step back. And the 76ers don't have Ben Simmons. So I got the Nets winning this division.
Absolutely. I think the Nets are going to be a pretty good team. But now on to the Central. I know, Isaiah, you're going to go bold on the Cleveland Cavaliers. We'll talk. I can't wait what your take is on the Cavs. And you might go bold on them, and I'm not really too sold on them just yet because I still think the Cleveland Cavaliers are a rebuilding team. I love this young core with Colin Sexton and Darius Garland. Those are really, really good guards there. And I think that they also have Jared Allen at center. They also got Mobley in the draft, who I think is going to be their future starting center. But could he overtake Jared Allen as the starter? And I don't think so, because I think Jared Allen is still the better player. And they also got Lauri Markkanen. I think Lauri Markkanen is now off to – now he has a fresh start. And I think he's gonna establish himself there in Cleveland. And for the Bucks, they're the defending champs. I think the Milwaukee Bucks, they're in it to win it in the long haul with Giannis and Chris Middleton. I think that the Bucks are in a really, really good place. The Detroit Pistons, I think they have a couple of good players. They got Bay, they got Killian Hayes, and then Cade Cunningham. He is my pick for Rookie of the Year, which I'll get to in a minute, and I'll explain why. I think Cade Cunningham is going to be that next best franchise player on the Detroit Pistons. And the Chicago Bulls. I talked about it off air with Isaiah and how fun they're going to be with Zach LaVine, with Lonzo Ball, and also with Nikola Vucevic, who's a really, really good stretch five that can shoot the three ball, defend, pass the ball, play make. And also talk about Patrick Williams, who they drafted last year. I think he's ready to take that next leap. And for the Pacers, I'm happy to see that Rick Carlisle is going to have his second go-around of the Pacers, because I feel like that he has unfinished business there. I love Miles Turner. He is like the franchise player on the Pacers. Malcolm Brogdon is good. I think Caris LeVert's good. But I think the Pacers are really built around Miles Turner.
Yeah, I completely agree with you, Loro. I think that for me, you know, even though I love what the Cavaliers are doing, I'm probably like one of the few out there that love what the Cleveland Cavaliers are doing and are as high on them as I am. I can't go that bold and pick them to win the division. I think that the Milwaukee Bucks are going to be the team that wins the division just because, you know, they got Giannis, best player, no doubt, in that division. Maybe the best player in the Eastern Conference. You know, you can argue all day whether it's Giannis or KD. The Bucks, they're in it to win it. Like you said, Loro, they got Jrue Holiday. They got Chris Middleton, who was great last year. They got Giannis. It's another year for Holiday under the system, Mike Budenhoser. They know how to win a championship now. They got, you know, all these great pieces. And I just think that they aren't going to be hung over. They're not going to take a step back. They are going to be back to where they were last year, and that is winning the Central Division. The Pistons, I think they have talent. They have a lot of young talent. I like what they're doing, but I think that they're a couple of years away. I think Dwayne Casey's the right coach to develop this young talent. Love Cade Cunningham. Love that pick. And I think that, you know, Detroit fans should definitely go out to the Little Caesars Arena in Detroit, because the Pistons are going to be a really exciting team to watch this upcoming season. The Bulls, like you said, Laurel, I'm as high on you on the Bulls, or I am as high on the Bulls as you are, because I think the Bulls – you look at the Chicago Bulls, Lonzo Ball, great IQ, great passer, really good defender. He's gotten better on the offensive side when it comes to scoring the basketball and shooting the three ball. Zach LaVine, he's a star. Nikola Vucevic, one of the most underrated centers in all of basketball. This dude gets overlooked by every single person when it comes to covering the NBA. He's a star. He's a monster when it comes to doing stuff in the paint and also rebounding the basketball and also passing the basketball, also being a great defender as well. They also have DeMar DeRozan, who can score the basketball at a really high level. They got Billy Donovan, who I really think is a really good coach. I really love Billy Donovan. I think the Bulls are going to be a really good team. And also, don't forget Alex Caruso. You know, everybody might be saying, like, oh, Alex Caruso, he's the guy that's known as the white Michael Jordan. Well, this dude can play. He's not just known for being a meme, but he's a guy that can play. He's a guy that is a good playmaker. He's a guy that can get to the rim. He's a guy that can, you know, slam the alley-oops down. He's a guy that's a really good defender as well, and a guy that I think Austin Reeves, the Lakers' young rookie, should really copy, especially on the defensive side of things. I think the Bulls will be good on defense. I think they'll be able to be good on offense with LaVine and also with DeMar DeRozan carrying the load and with Vucevic. The Bulls are going to be a top 5 team in the Eastern Conference this year, no doubt in mind. They're going to be good, but I just can't put them over the Milwaukee Bucks just yet. Rick Carlisle and his Pacers, I think that they are going to be good. But I don't think they're going to be good enough to either challenge the Bulls or the Bucks for this division. I just think that, you know, Brogdon is good. LeVert, he's going to be good. Miles Turner is going to be good. But how about the rest of the team? You know, the rest of the team, you can't just rely on three players to be good and the rest of the team be crap. So you have to have a team.
I forgot one player to mention on the Pacers. It's Domantas Sabonis. I love that kid. I love that guy. He's a very good playmaker, and I think the Pacers won that trade when they sent Paul George to the Oklahoma City Thunder. Getting Domantas Sabonis and Victor Oladipo in that deal, I think the Pacers really won that trade.
Yeah, dude, Domantas Sabonis is a stud, man. He's a really good player. He was an All-Star, I believe, last year. He's gonna be good for them, but I need the supporting cast to step up if they really want to get to the Bucks and the Bulls level. And then you look at the Cleveland Cavaliers. You know, the Cleveland Cavaliers, I love Colin Sexton. I think that this guy is one of the most underrated players in the NBA. I don't know why a lot of people hate on him. I don't get the reasoning because I think this guy can score really good. He's a really good basketball player in this league. Garland, I see the improvement that he made. I think he's going to take another step up. And then you see what they got. They have Kevin Love. Don't forget about him. Kevin Love can – you know, staying healthy for him is going to be a problem. But if he can play like 50 games out of 32, out of 82, I mean, I think that's going to be good for the Cavaliers because Kevin Love, when healthy, he can still play, maybe not as the star that he once was, but he can still play quality, solid basketball in the NBA. Lauri Markkanen, he's going to be good for the Cavs. I like that move for Cleveland. Mobley, I think he's going to have to sit behind Jared Allen just because I don't think he's ready physically for the NBA. You looked at James Wiseman last year. He was a stud coming into the NBA, but he just wasn't physically ready for the grind of NBA basketball. So I think the Cavs are going to be a good team. I think the Cavs are a team that, you know, everybody should watch out for because they do have a lot of young talent. And J.B. Bickerstaff is a good, young, up-and-coming coach. But I can't pick them to win the division, though I do am picking them to make the playoffs, though.
Yeah, absolutely. But anyways, let's go to the Southeast Division. So Jared Peterson also said, I'm going to shock you all. I think LaMelo Ball and the Hornets win the division. I'm like, I'm not going to put them up there just yet. I really love that roster with LaMelo Ball and Miles Bridges. I think the Hornets are going to be a fun team. They have a bright future ahead of them to win championships. I think they're building their next winning franchise with LaMelo Ball because I know Michael Jordan is going to want to go for it in the near future and be a recruit for players, for superstars to play in Charlotte. So let's talk about these teams. I'm going to start first. Before I pick the winner, the Orlando Magic, they are in rebuild mode. Cole Anthony is going to be a great asset to this team. And losing Aaron Gordon last year, I thought that it was a huge blow to the Orlando Magic, but I think that it just tells me that the organization is a mess. And I also think that the Orlando Magic will be good, but I still think that they have up and coming players that really can really help them in the future, like Gary Harris, who they got in the Aaron Gordon deal. I think Gary Harris is a really, really good fit for the Orlando Magic. And also, what are you going to see from Markelle Fultz? Is he going to take that next leap? Is Terrence Ross their best player? I think Terrence Ross is awesome. And the Miami Heat, like we talked about, and I love that roster with Jimmy Butler, Kyle Lowry, and Bam Adebayo. And I don't mean to be biased because I am Filipino, and Eric Spoelstra is Filipino, and I love Eric Spoelstra. I would say because he's Filipino, the same heritage as I am. I just think Eric Spoelstra is a great coach. My mom knew Pat Riley at the time, so that's why. And Eric Spoelstra came from the Pat Riley coaching tree. And I think Eric Spoelstra has done a tremendous job coaching this Miami Heat team. And I think Pat Riley has done a really, really good job of building that roster. And I think that the Miami Heat will be back to being a destination for NBA talent to come to play in South Beach. I think they're building their next winning team around Jimmy Butler and Kyle Lowry. That's such a big pickup right there. great pickup for the Heat to get Kyle Lowry. And then Duncan Robinson being back is also a really, really good thing. I love Tyler Hero. He is a fantastic basketball player that can run back dunks. He kind of reminds me of how Shannon Brown played his game. And he's a really, really good defender, clutch scorer, gets out in transition, and he hustles. And I really think that the Miami Heat are going to do really big things this year. The Atlanta Hawks. I love the Atlanta Hawks roster. This is such a talented group with Trae Young and Bogdan Bogdanovic. And I really think that the Atlanta Hawks are ready to compete in the Eastern Conference. And I really think that Nate McMillan is in the right situation, because I think that Nate McMillan has done a tremendous job coaching the Atlanta Hawks, because I think he's a better coach than Lloyd Pierce. Lloyd Pierce is a good coach, but I didn't think the players played hard for him. I think Nate McMillan is in the right situation. I felt like the Pacers should have not fired him a year ago. I really think that Nate McMillan is the right person to lead the Atlanta Hawks and into the future. And I talked about the Charlotte Hornets. I think that this team can really, really take off this year with LaMelo Ball and also Miles Bridges. This team has such a bright future ahead of them. And the Washington Wizards, they got my guy Kyle Kuzma, who I miss on the Lakers. Montrezl Harrell, I think, is a great pickup for them, along with Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. But really, I think the Washington Wizards are built around Bradley Beal. I think Rui Hachimura is going to be very, very good. I think he's going to take his game to the next level. I love that kid. I think he's going to be a star in the making. I think Denny Avdija, I think, is going to be very good as well. But I think that the Washington Wizards, they can really be a good – they can really be in the mix for a playoff spot. But I think – but I'm not going to put them over Miami or Charlotte here. So, anyways, Isaiah, I picked the Miami Heat to win the Southeast Division.
Yeah, it looks like I'm going to agree with you pretty much on all of these division picks. I think, you know, a lot of these are no-brainer. I think the Miami Heat's going to win this division. I think that when you look at this division, it's going to be a fun division to watch. It's going to be between the Heat and the Hawks for this division. But I just think the Miami Heat, the veteran experience that they have, I just think that will take them over the top and over the Hawks for this division. When you look at this division, Loro, the Miami Heat, I said earlier, watch out for the Miami Heat. They are going to be a great, great basketball team this season. I think they're going to make a lot of noise this NBA season. I liked what they did in the offseason. They have Jimmy Butler. They had Bam Adebayo. But what the Heat was missing was they needed another quote-unquote all-star caliber player to pair with Jimmy Butler. Well, they got that in Kyle Lowry, who, even though he's like 36 years of age, he can still play at a really high level. He can distribute the basketball at a high level. He can score the basketball at a high level. And last year, he had a career year when it came to shooting the three, and he's just getting better and better and better as he ages, and he's a dog on the defensive side of things. So him and Jimmy Butler, I think, will really, really connect with each other, and I think they're going to gel really well. And then you have the other guys. Hero looked great in the preseason. He looked much better than Tyler Hero that we knew of from last year. Duncan Robinson got paid a lot of money. He looks really good in preseason. And then don't forget, they got PJ Tucker, who's a dog also on the defensive side of the ball. He can really shoot the three extremely well as well. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, Victor Oladipo, who, even though he's injured, he came back on a minimum contract. So I think if he's healthy, and if he can go back to being like a 50% of the Victor Oladipo of old, I think the Miami Heat are going to be a team to be reckoned with out there in the Eastern Conference. The Magic, they're in rebuild mode. Jamal Mosley's going to be having his hands full with all the young talent there in Miami. Watch out for, you know, Wagner. I think he's going to be a good player for the Miami Heat. I like Jalen Suggs. I think the...
are you talking about the Orlando Magic?
Yeah, my bad. The Orlando Magic. I think the Magic... they have a lot of great young talent with Wagner and also with Jalen Suggs, but they're just a couple of years away from contending for a play-in tournament spot in the Eastern Conference. The Hawks, you know, Nate McMillan, he's a fantastic coach. Trae Young is a phenomenal talent. And John Collins is great. Herter is great. They're going to be right there in the mix with the Heat, but I just think the Heat will take it because of their championship veteran experience that they have in South Beach. The Hornets, like you said, Laurel, I'm not going to go as far as Jared Peterson because I think that they're going to be a fun team to watch with LaMelo Ball, who, you know, he's going to be, I mean, him, Bridges, and all the young talent that they have there, they are going to be Charlotte's version of Showtime. Like, they're going to be must-see TV, but they just are not that experienced. They don't really play great defense. And until they start playing really good defense, I just can't pick the Charlotte Hornets over the Heat and the Hawks to win the division and the Wizards. I think Kuzma, you know, everybody always laughs at him. I think Kuzma will be – he will be a much better player with the Wizards because now it's going to be him in the starting lineup. And I think he's the guy that needs to be in the starting lineup rather than being off the bench because he takes time to get his rhythm going. When he gets his rhythm going, you know, he's a really good scorer on the basket, on the offensive side. So I think the Wizards, I like Kuzma, I like Harrow, but Loro, Bradley Beal is going to be a free agent, I believe, after this season. He's got like an opt-out clause, and do not be shocked, Loro, if Bradley Beal gets traded at the trade deadline, because I just don't think the Wizards will be in contention anytime soon. And I think that they're going to have to try to get something for Bradley Beal because I think he's going to walk at the end of the season and go to a new team because he really wants to win since he's, I think, 28 now. And I think the Wizards are going to have to trade him because if you don't trade him, you're going to lose him for nothing. And he's a superstar in this league, so you might as well trade him and get a huge haul back in return.
They should. I mean, the Wizards definitely, if they trade, like they did with John Wall, they did trade John Wall to the Rockets, and they got Russell Westbrook in return. And then that turned out to work. That worked out okay, but I felt like Russell Westbrook wanted to be in a good situation that he can win rings, and that's why he's a Laker, and I'm happy that he is a Laker. But with the Hornets, I love I think James Borrego is the right coach to rebuild this team for the Charlotte Hornets. And Jamal Mosley, you said that he is going to have his hands full with this young core. And then Wes Unseld Jr., I think he is the right fit to coach the Washington Wizards because his father played there, and I think he knows the organization very well. I think the Wizards some way, somehow, you can't sleep on them still.
Yeah, sorry about that. I was muted. But, yeah, I think the Wizards, I think they're going to be a decent team, but I just don't see them in contention for the division title or for the top eight playoff spots. Maybe a play-in tournament spot, but I don't know. They really struggled last year out of the gate. And if they struggle against this year, you know, Russell Westbrook's not there anymore. You're going to have to rely on these young kids to really help propel you, and I just don't see Kuzma or Harrell doing that for the Washington Wizards.
Absolutely. Now that's the fun part. Let's make our West and East predictions. Let's start with the Western Conference. I got number one, the Los Angeles Lakers. Number two, I got the Phoenix Suns. Number three, I got the LA Clippers. Number four, the Denver Nuggets. Number five, I got the Dallas Mavericks. And then number six, I got the Golden State Warriors. Number seven, I got the Portland Trail Blazers playing in the play-in tournament with the Utah Jazz, even though, I mean, people will rip me for saying this. Why is Utah number eight? And I'll be like, guys, the West is so competitive. Utah is a great team. But if they get into a play-in seed, it's okay because that's how good the Western Conference is. And then number nine, I got the San Antonio Spurs, and then I got the Memphis Grizzlies at number 10 yet again.
Wow, I like those predictions a lot, Loro. But for me, I got the Lakers as number one. I think they will be winning a lot of games for this season. I would not be shocked. I know I made this prediction that they're going to win 70 games, but you know, I think they're going to be like load managing a lot, especially late in the season. So I would not be shocked if the Lakers – I don't know if they're going to win 70. That might be a stretch, but I could definitely see the Lakers winning in the high 60s when it comes to the regular season wins. So I got the Lakers as number one. The Nuggets for me are going to be the number two seed. I love Denver. I love what they're doing. Phoenix is going to be number three. I got the Dallas Mavericks as number four. I got the Jazz at number five. I got the Warriors actually at number six. I think the Golden State Warriors will be decent. But they won't be very good until Klay comes back. And I think they'll make that run when Klay Thompson comes back in December or in early January. For me, the Clippers are going to be number seven just because, you know, Kawhi Leonard is not there. And I just don't see Paul George carrying the Clippers by himself to a top five seed in the Western Conference. Then number eight, Laurel, this is probably going to surprise you. I got the New Orleans Pelicans, actually.
I got the Pelicans
as number eight because I think Zion, he's out for, I believe, the first couple of weeks, but he's going to be back. And you know, Laurel, this NBA season is a marathon. You know, it's about who finishes strong in the end. And I just love the Willie Green hiring. I think Willie Green is going to bring stability to this locker room. I think he's a guy that's going to make this locker room come together and have great chemistry. And that's what the Pelicans were missing last year. They have great talent, but they just don't have the chemistry and are not coming together. And I think that this will be the year that they finally come together. And I think Brandon Ingram takes that next step in his development into being a superstar for the Pelicans. So I got them as eight. The Blazers for me are number nine, just because, like you said, Laurel, with the Jazz, why do we have the Blazers, or why do I have the Blazers so low? It's not because they're a bad team. It's because the West is so, so tough. And there's just so many great teams to pick from in the Western Conference. I got them as nine, and I got the Grizzlies as number 10, just because, again, the West is so tough. Like, literally, besides probably the Lakers and the Nuggets and the Suns, from the Mavericks, Jazz, Warriors, Clippers, from, like, number four all the way to number 10, it could be a pickup. You could just pick anyone into those spots, and you could be right, because that's just how tough and how loaded the Western Conference really is.
Yeah, and I want to say something about the Pelicans. I have the Pelicans challenging the Grizzlies for that 10 spot in that play-in tournament thing, but I feel like that Memphis is the better team, so I have the Pelicans right there, just right on the brink. But I could understand why you went bold here, because you think that the Pelicans are ready to get that play-in spot.
Well, they better, because if they don't, David Griffin is going to be out. Since David Griffin, when he came there, he was supposed to come there to build, you know, this team. And he's done a good job, you know, putting the young pieces there. But now it's about them coming together and taking the next step and start winning basketball games.
Absolutely. Now let's go on to the Eastern Conference standings and who I have in the East and my standings. Number one. With a fully healthy roster, and this team is a super team. They're built just like the Lakers. And if Kyrie plays or not, I think the Brooklyn Nets will remain. I have them as the number one seed in the East. Number two, I got the Milwaukee Bucks, the defending NBA champion. And I think that this team is definitely one of the teams to beat in the East. Number three, you might agree with me on this. I got the Miami Heat number three, because last year, they had struggles last year. They still were managed to make it to the playoffs, but in the end, they just got swept by the Milwaukee Bucks as revenge. But I think the Miami Heat are going to be right there on the heels of the Nets and the Bucks. And number four, I got the Philadelphia 76ers dropping a bit. And then I got the Atlanta Hawks as the number five seed. And I think that the Atlanta Hawks are going to be that five seed that everybody's going to be talking about. And hey, they might even knock out the Brooklyn Nets out of the playoffs in the second round. We'll see. That could very well happen. Number six, the Chicago Bulls. They are ready. They are ready to compete. I can't wait to see what this team's going to do this season. I am very high on this roster. It was in the past, everybody was like, oh, without Jimmy Butler, the Bulls are in dysfunction. I think that the Bulls are back. I can't wait to see the Chicago Bulls being back to being one of the NBA's elite. And I think they were in the past in the 90s with Michael Jordan. And the Bulls spent a lot of money on talent. And I really think that the Bulls are going to be very good this year. And I think Lonzo Ball and Zach LaVine, both guys from my neck of the woods from UCLA, they're going to be great together. The Indiana Pacers, I have them number seven. I think they're going to play the Charlotte Hornets again in the play-in tournament. And then the Boston Celtics, I have them at number eight. People will tell me why, but I'll say it's because I really think that – I think the Celtics will make the playoffs regardless, but it's going to be either in a play-in situation or maybe top six. We'll see. And then number nine, I got the New York Knicks, because I really think it all comes down to coaching. That's why I have the New York Knicks in there. What about you? I know you might go bold with this one.
Don't worry, Lolo. I'm not picking the Cavaliers to be my number one team. But for me, you know, I'm going to have to disagree with you. I think it's the Milwaukee Bucks for me as number one, just because, I mean, you could put any of those two teams, one and two. Doesn't really matter. It could be a coin flip. That's what I think it's going to be this year. But I got the Bucks just because, you know, I don't think Kyrie's going to play. And I think that's a big loss for the Brooklyn Nets, because Kyrie, when he's out there playing on the basketball court, he's a major, major talent. And without him, yes, you have Harden, you have Durant, but they do have to incorporate a lot of the other pieces that they added in free agency and also in the offseason. So I just think the Bucks, they've been together, they have continuity, and I bank it on the continuity over a team that is talented but needs time to gel and needs time to have chemistry. I'm picking the Bucks to be the number one team over the Nets. Number two, Brooklyn Nets. For me, number three, Laurel, I'm going to agree with you. The Miami Heat, you know, I talked a lot about them already. I think they're going to be a really good team this year. Number four, it's the Atlanta Hawks. I think the Hawks, Trae Young and co, they're definitely going to be a top four team in the Eastern Conference. Number five, I got the Chicago Bulls, actually. I think the Bulls, like you said, they're ready. They got a team that has a lot of young talent. They got a lot of good talent there in Chicago, and Billy Donovan's a really good coach. I mean, this dude took an Oklahoma City Thunder team with Chris Paul that wasn't even supposed to win more than 40 games in the Western Conference. He took them to the playoffs, and they were one win away from beating the Houston Rockets, who had James Harden at the time in the first round. So he's a really good coach. Billy Donovan and the Bulls, I think, will be number five. Sixers, I think they will be six, because I like Joel Embiid, I like Tobias Harris, but I think the loss of Ben Simmons, even though a lot of people are saying, like, Ben Simmons, he can't shoot, all that stuff, I get it. But Ben Simmons brings a lot of stuff to the table that is often forgotten in the NBA, like rebounding and defense and playmaking. And I think that's a big loss for them. And I don't think he's going to play at all this year for the Sixers. I actually have him traded the first couple of months in the regular season. So I got the Sixers at six. Number seven, Loro, you ready for this, my man? This is probably going to be one of the biggest shocks to you in this entire show. And that is the Cleveland Cavaliers. I said they're going to make the playoffs. They have a lot of young talent. They're like the Bulls. They have a lot of young talent. But the only difference between the Bulls and the Cavaliers is coaching. Billy Donovan over JB Bickerstaff, no doubt about that. But the Cavaliers, Sexton, Garland, young emerging talent, Lauri Markkanen, Kevin Love, who can still play at a solid level, plus Jared Allen, who is a monster in the paint when it comes to rebounding and blocking shots and throwing down those alley-oops. And also, watch out for Dylan Windler. When this kid is healthy, this kid is he's tremendous when it comes to shooting the ball from behind the arc. So I got the Cavs at number seven. The Celtics for me are number eight, just because they have so many question marks. I don't really know about them. I know Tatum and Brown are going to be good, but that's the only thing I know about the Boston Celtics. The Pacers for me are number nine. I like Rick Carlisle. I like Brogdon. I like Turner. And I like Sabonis as well. And LeVert too. They're going to be good, but they're not going to be good enough for me to be a top eight playoff team in the East. And the number 10, I got the New York Knicks, just because I think they're going to take a step back. I think they really overachieved last year. And I don't know if you can count on Kemba Walker or Loro to be healthy. So those are my Eastern Conference standings.
I definitely can see where you're going with this. I mean, the Cavs are good, but I think that, in my opinion, I think the Cavs are probably going to be not making the playoffs just because their roster is so young. But with the Knicks, you're right. It's going to depend on if Kemba Walker can stay healthy. And if he can stay healthy, I think that the Knicks can definitely make a play-in seed. But the reason why I have the Knicks making the playoffs is I really think that the Knicks, it's going to come down to coaching. And I think Tom Thibodeau's a great coach. He's still got Derrick Rose, who still could play at a high level, and he's really starting to play like the Derrick Rose we once know, and trying to return to his MVP form back in 2010 and 2011, and we'll go from there here. So now let's talk about the fun stuff. Let's go to our awards pick. So let's start with our pick, will be for NBA Most Valuable Player Award. So I'm going to go first with this one. My pick, this guy who we got from the Washington Wizards is going to make an immediate impact right away. He won MVP when he was a member of the Oklahoma City Thunder. The reason why I love this player, I've always been a big fan of him, is because I love his tenacity. I love his defense. He's a triple-double machine. And even though that he can get cocky at times, it's because he is passionate about the game of basketball, and he just wants to show that he can be an elite player, and he is a technical foul machine at times. Give me Russell Westbrook as my pick for NBA Most Valuable Player Award. He's going to win a second one, and it's going to be him this year.
Wow, what a great pick, Lil Roy. I love that bold pick that you just threw out there. But for me, I'm going to go with a Laker, just like you. But I'm not going with Russ. I'm going to go with another Laker, and that is Anthony Davis. I think Anthony Davis bounces back big time, and he's going to have a monster year. He heard all the critics all offseason about how he's so soft, how he's made of glass, how he can't stay healthy, how he's not one of the top five players in all of basketball. Well, Anthony Davis heard that, and he worked his butt off all offseason to get back to playing, to get his body back, to get back in shape, because let's admit it, he was not in shape last year. He was still hungover from that championship that he won in the bubble. So he wasn't in shape. It was not a full off season last year for Anthony Davis, and also for most of the players in the NBA, because they just, like, you saw the impact. You know, a lot of players got hurt last season. I think Anthony Davis bounces back. I think he's going to be back to being a top five player in all of basketball. And I think that you were right, Loro. Russell Westbrook is a great addition to the Los Angeles Lakers. And you know who's it's going to be really beneficial to? It's going to be beneficial to LeBron James. Don't get me wrong. But it's going to be beneficial more to Anthony Davis, because he's going to be able to put Anthony Davis in the best places to succeed with him and LeBron James. And you can't put all the attention on LeBron. You certainly can't leave Westbrook wide, or you can leave him wide open, but Westbrook can hurt you when it comes to driving to the basket. And when he drives to the basket, you're going to have to put two or three defenders on him. Guess who that leaves open? Anthony Davis. I think Anthony Davis will wreak havoc in the NBA, and I think that he wins the Most Valuable Player.
I have Anthony Davis winning an award this year, but it's going to be one of the other. It's going to be in a different category. So the next pick I got, the next award we're going to talk about is Coach of the Year. I've got to say that he has made a difference since taking over the Lakers in the 2019-2020 season, and he was really good coaching the Indiana Pacers, but it didn't work out for him in his only stint with the Orlando Magic, because he was coaching a rebuilding roster. He couldn't control that. But he has LeBron James, Anthony Davis, and Russell Westbrook with him. Although, I'll tell you this, although I do think that Steve Nash, Steve Kerr, those guys, and Greg Popovich, I think those guys will be in the running for Coach of the Year, along with Billy Donovan, of course, like what Mess Around Dave said, and Eric Spoelstra. Give me Frank Vogel as this year's Coach of the Year. But also, before you go, Isaiah, I will also throw in Mike Malone and Quinn Snyder in the mix for Coach of the Year.
Laurel, I got a quick question for you before I give my answer. For Coach of the Year, is it Western Conference have a Coach of the Year and the Eastern Conference has a Coach of the Year, or are they combined into one award for the entire NBA?
It's combined for the whole NBA, for the whole season. So, so that's why I wanted to get that clear. So that's what Coach of the Year is.
All right, so for me, you know, I have a lot of great candidates, just because, you know, when you look at my predictions, you could certainly give it to J.B. Bickerstaff, who, if the Cavs make the playoffs, which I'm predicting, and they are in the seventh seed, then, you know, he definitely has a valid shot at winning the award. You know, Billy Donovan, Bulls, I got them at number five. From missing the playoffs, from missing the play-in to being a top five seed, that's definitely worthy of Coach of the Year. You know, and then, you know, you can give it to Jason Kidd as well, because I got the Mavs at number four. If they finish at number four, that's, you know, definitely an argument that you could make. But I'm going to go with Dave. I'm going to go with Billy Donovan for my Coach of the Year award, just because I think that, you know, he is going to be making the biggest impact out of everybody. Yes, you could give it to Frank Vogel. You could give it to Monty Williams. You could give it to Mike Budenholzer. You could give it to Steve Nash. But Billy Donovan, if our predictions are right, you take a team that did not make the playoffs, did not even make the play-in the year before, to a top five team in the Eastern Conference, give that man that trophy.
Yes, and I also want to add something about Mike Budenholzer real quick. I mean, Mike Budenholzer was under pressure last year, and everybody was like, if Milwaukee did not win the championship, he was going to get the boot in Milwaukee. And look what he did. He took the Bucks to a championship, and he won.
Exactly. He won. What a great job he did.
He was really good. Now let's talk about Executive of the Year. Although, I'll tell you what, there is a lot of really, really good executives out there, like Bob Myers. Talk about Lawrence Frank. Talk about those two, or Mark Cuban, who's also the owner and GM of the Dallas Mavericks here, and Daryl Morey, who I really think he is a fantastic executive with Houston. I think he's doing really good things with the Philadelphia 76ers. I think Brad Stevens is also going to relish that role. My pick for Executive of the Year, I'm giving it to the Lakers GM, and he is a genius, and he has done a fantastic job since being that new voice in that front office since Mitch Kupchak got fired, and that is Rob Pelinka. He is a genius.
I agree. I think he's a genius. I think he's doing a great, great job since Mitch Kupchak got fired. But Rob Pelinka, for some reason, is not liked in the NBA execs circle for some reason. I don't know. Maybe it has something to do with what happened when he was an agent back when he was the agent for Kobe Bryant. So even though he's well-deserving, I just don't think he's going to get it because, you know, the NBA, let's face it, the NBA awards is more of a popularity contest than it is, like, for well-deserving. I think Pelinka will be well-deserving, but I just don't think he gets it. So for me, I'm going to actually go, Loro, believe it or not, with Kobe Altman, the GM of the Cavs, just because I think that if the Cavs make the playoffs, how can you not give it to him since he did a great job putting this young team together? They haven't made the playoffs in, what, like 5 years now, if I'm not mistaken?
Yeah, since LeBron was there. And also, yeah. Don't be shocked if David Griffin even's in the conversation if the – Pelicans step it up this year.
Exactly. David Griffin, if they step it up, he could definitely be in the conversation. But I think you got to give it to Kobe Altman. If the Cavs make the playoff, not the play-in, I'm talking about the actual playoffs. If they make the playoffs and play a seven-game series, no matter if they lose or not, or if they win or lose, he's definitely well-deserving because they haven't made the playoffs in a really, really long time. And that organization was very dysfunctional before he got here. So I got to go with Kobe Altman.
All right. Now let's talk about Rookie of the Year. So with my pick for Rookie of the Year, I was thinking, will this be a unanimous choice or will it be a very, very tough race? My pick for Rookie of the Year for the NBA this year, I am going to pick Cade Cunningham.
Wow, great pick, Loro. For me, I'm not going to go with Cade Cunningham, even though he was the number one pick. I'm going to go with Jalen Suggs from the Orlando Magic. I think that it's going to be a great race. I think it's going to be a really thrilling race. But I just think that Cade Cunningham, he's going to be great for the Detroit Pistons. But I think Jalen Suggs will have the most impact out of all the rookies simply because this is his team now. The Orlando Magic is Jalen Suggs' team. And I think that he will have every opportunity in the world to do whatever he wants when it comes to scoring, playmaking, and just being the face of the franchise. And you look at Ja Morant. Why did Ja Morant win Rookie of the Year? He was great. Why was he great? Because he was giving every opportunity to succeed. He literally had the ball in his hands and could do whatever the heck he wanted for the Memphis Grizzlies. That's going to be the same thing that happens with Jalen Suggs.
Also, don't rule out Jalen Green like you talked about. Jalen Green was from the G League, and I think Jalen Green is definitely a fantastic addition. And now with James Harden and Russell Westbrook gone, I think that Jalen Green is going to be that new phase of the franchise for the Rockets and that they're going to build their next winning team around.
Yeah, I think he's going to be great for the Houston Rockets. Don't get me wrong. He's going to be good. Cunningham's going to be good. I think it's going to be a thrilling race between these three rookies, Suggs, Green, and also Cade Cunningham. But I just think Jalen Suggs, he's going to be in the Ja Morant role. He's going to literally have the ball in his hands and can do whatever the heck he wants to down there in Orlando.
All right, now to our next pick. Sixth man of the year. You want to have somebody that is going to come off the bench and score you a lot of points. So for me, it comes down to three players. One of them is my pick to win Sixth Man of the Year award. Jordan Clarkson won it last year, and I'll tell you why I have him repeating in just a few minutes. But I also have other guys in mind that could definitely win this award, like Lou Williams. He's definitely a guy that is in it to win that award each and every season. And also, don't rule out Eric Bledsoe if he can get the job done. And then Corey Joseph can win it too. But I can only give it to one player. And I am going to give it to I think it's going to be a repeat winner this year. I'm going to give it to Jordan Clarkson, former Laker. And I think he has done a fantastic job with the Utah Jazz. And if you talk about really good sixth men, Jordan Clarkson has really relished that role.
I completely agree with you. I'm going to go with Jordan Clarkson, Loro, just like you do, because I think he's a fantastic scorer off the bench. But do not be surprised if Carmelo Anthony is in the conversation, just because I think that when you have Westbrook, when you have AD, when you have LeBron James, everybody's going to be fixated their attention on those three players, which will give ample opportunity and a lot of open shots for Carmelo Anthony. So do not be shocked if Carmelo Anthony is in the conversation. I don't think he's going to win it, just because I think Jordan Clarkson will put up more and better numbers than Carmelo Anthony.
All right. So now let's talk about defensive. Let's talk about most improved player of the year award. I give it to a guy that not necessarily would have a bad season and that comes back strong the next year. I like to give it to a guy that hasn't gone the way it has in the first 3 or 4 years in the NBA and that really has taken that next level, like Julius Randle did last year. Julius Randle took his game to a whole another level. He was an all-star this year. He was a guy that had trouble on his game when he was a Laker, and he was a guy that had talent. He had the upside and the wingspan to be really, really good. But at the same time, I like to give it to a guy that is really going to show that he can really be that superstar tandem and most improved player of the year award. I don't like to give it to a guy that is like having a bad year this year and then the next year you come out strong. I like to give it to a guy that really has worked on his craft and his game in the years in upcoming years, and it could be a Cinderella story type pick. I'm going to go with Lonzo Ball. Like you said, improved shot form, and he's a guy that's really improved defensively and a guy that can shoot the three ball. He has that talent. He's not the guy that shoots from this side anymore. He's really, really changed his form. Give me Lonzo Ball.
I'm very tempted to go with Dave's pick, because I think that if the Cavaliers do in fact make the playoffs and, you know, be the seventh seed, Colin Sexton's got to have a monster year for the Cleveland Cavaliers. And I think he's going to play angry, because today the Cavaliers lowballed him and didn't give him, you know, that type of extension that he was seeking. And I think it was a mistake by the Cavaliers. So I think Colin Sexton, he definitely will be in the conversation. But, Loro, I'm going to go with Jordan Poole of the Golden State Warriors. I think Jordan Poole, he looked amazing in the preseason. He looks fantastic down the stretch last season, and I think he's going to continue to ball out for the Golden State Warriors, especially with Klay Thompson sidelined for the first couple of months. He's going to get every opportunity to succeed next to Steph Curry. And I think even when Klay Thompson comes back, I think the Warriors will move him to small forward to not have to have him run around on the court as much so he can save his legs. And I think Jordan Poole with Steph Curry getting a lot of attention fixated on him, with Klay Thompson getting a lot of attention fixated on him, even with Andrew Wiggins getting a lot of attention fixated on him, I think Jordan Poole will get a lot of opportunities, a lot of open shots for him, and I think he's going to thrive in the Bay with the Golden State Warriors.
Oh, absolutely. Those picks we had aren't bad, but that's how I talk about most improved player. So now let's talk about defensive player of the year. You have to have the right mentality and the right stats to be considered for this award. But this player, I'm going to tell you, I really think that he should have gotten it in the 2019-2020 season in his first year with the Lakers. I won't rule out Giannis in that mix, along with Joel Embiid. Talk about Luka Doncic being in that conversation, along with Nikola Jokic and Domantas Sabonis. And I want to say that my pick to be this year's Defensive Player of the Year award, I'm going to say it until he actually wins it, Rudy Gobert is going to be in that conversation too. I think there's going to be a lot of really, really good guys to be in that mix. I'm going to go with Anthony Davis to win Defensive Player of the Year award.
I like the pick, Laurel, but I got to agree with Dave. I just think that Rudy Gobert, he's like a guy that's always in that mix, if not winning Defensive Player of the Year award. If you go into the paint, forget about getting a shot off against Rudy Gobert, because he's just going to swat that thing out of the way all of the time. So give me Rudy Gobert. I just think Rudy Gobert, he's tremendous defensively. He's a great shot blocker. He's a great rim protector for the Utah Jazz, and he's a big part of the Utah Jazz's success.
He sure is. Now let's talk about, before we talk about conference finals and NBA finals prediction segment, let's predict who is going to be the first head coach to be fired this year. For me, I would not want to see Luke Walton be the first one to get fired, because as a Laker fan, Luke Walton was not a good basketball player. He was an okay head coach when he was with us. I mean, I thought he was going to be the right person to kind of gradually rebuild the Lakers, but the Lakers wanted to go into another direction. That's why they parted ways with him. And he's definitely on the hot seat in Sacramento. I really, really could see that. But I also think J.B. Bickerstaff is on the hot seat as well in Cleveland, because I really think that the Cavs want to be ready to contend. And also, I would put – I don't have a long list of coaches on the hot seat, but I think Luke Walton is the only one that is definitely on the hot seat. But if he is the first one to get fired out of the head coaches this year, then I'm not going to be shocked, because I feel like that Luke Walton, his tenure with Sacramento could come to an end because of how bad this organization is and how bad of an owner Vivek really is. And Isaiah, I know you would agree with me on that.
Yeah, unfortunately, because I'm a Lakers fan, I don't want to see this happen. I just think that right now, when you look at it, there's been so much turnover in the NBA when it comes to coaching. There's so many new coaches this year, and I just don't think that there's really going to be that many coaches that get fired and are on the hot seat, because there's just been so much turnover in the NBA. So for me, I think right now Luke Walton is like the only coach that's on the hot seat. I think that J.B. Bickerstaff, I could see your point, Laurel. I think he is kind of on not a hot seat, but I think a warm seat. I think that if Cleveland gets off to a bad start, watch out. J.B. Bickerstaff might be gone. I think Cleveland, they want to contend for a playoff spot this year, but I have them, you know, making the playoffs. So I think he's going to be saved, and I think he's going to be off the hot seat, because I think he's going to make the playoffs with the Cavs. So I got to go with Luke Walton. If Luke Walton does not make the playoffs, he's a guaranteed gone in Sacramento.
Absolutely. You're absolutely right about that. Now let's go on to our conference finals and NBA finals predictions. This is the fun part. It doesn't have to be the same matchups I pick. We can totally be different here. So let's start with the Eastern Conference. So my pick to go in the Eastern Conference Finals, I have the Milwaukee Bucks going up against the Brooklyn Nets, and I have the Brooklyn Nets in seven. What about you, Isaiah?
Wow, Laurel, this is going to be a really fun, you know, playoffs for both the West and the East, because just how loaded both conferences are. But I got to stick to what I said to you pre-show. I got to go with the Heat and the Bucks. The Brooklyn Nets for me, and I've been saying this for a while now, the Brooklyn Nets, in my opinion, I do not think they are going to make the Eastern Conference Finals just because of the loss of Kyrie Irving. Because you have a lot of great teams in the Eastern Conference, the Bucks, the Heat, who I've been, you know, raving about, the the Bulls, I don't think they're going to be, you know, in that mix, but they can still, you know, be an upstart team, maybe just like the Hawks were last year. Plus, you have the Atlanta Hawks as well. I think that Harden and Durant can get you past a lot of teams in the East, but I think to get past truly some of the elite teams like the Heat and like the Bucks, you're going to need Kyrie Irving and you're going to need that third star for the Brooklyn Nets. And without Kyrie, I think the Miami Heat, with their defensive intensity, with Lowry, with Butler, with Adebayo, with Hero, with Robinson, I just think that they're going to be able to knock out the Nets in the second round and set up a matchup with the defending champion Milwaukee Bucks in the Eastern Conference Finals. And as far as the Eastern Conference Finals Heat-Bucks matchup is concerned, I got to go with the Bucks. I like the Heat. I think the Heat are going to be successful, but I just think that Giannis is on a whole other level. And I just think the talent that they got in Milwaukee, the continuity that they have, will trump what the Miami Heat does. So give me the Bucks. I'm going to go with Bucks in six. I think it's going to be a really competitive and really thrilling series in the Eastern Conference Finals. And Laura, did you give your Western Conference Finals yet, or have you not gone yet?
I haven't done my Western Conference Finals pick, so I'm going to go with Chris Paul versus LeBron James, as the Lakers will go head-to-head with the Phoenix Suns. And I say that because I think that the Suns will make it far again. They're going to make another deep playoff run with Chris Paul, and I want to see Chris Paul and LeBron James meet again in the playoffs. So I'm going to say the Lakers in seven in that contest. And the reason why in those two those matchups I have going in seven is because I really think that in those type of games, the Eastern Conference Finals and the Western Conference Finals, they must go seven games if the matchup is so good. I would predict sweeps if it's – I predict sweeps if it's like a number one seed versus number eight seed, that the number one seed would easily sweep this team. That's the only sweeps I predict.
Loro, for me, I'm about to drop a bombshell on you, buddy. I'm about to drop a shocker on you. I actually have the Suns losing in the first round to the Golden State Warriors.
What?
Yeah.
Oh,
I think it's going to be a great series. But once again, I just think with Curry being back, with Jordan Poole, I expect him to take that next step up, with Klay Thompson coming back, Draymond Green, let's not forget, this Warriors team is still really, really good. And that's going to be a hell of a series. And I think we'll go seven games. But I just think ultimately, I just think the Warriors have more more explosive talent than the Phoenix Suns. So I got the Suns losing actually in the first round of the Warriors. But, you know, the Suns, they got to do all they can to avoid Golden State in the first round. You do not want to play Golden State in the first round if you're any team in the Western Conference. But I'm going to go with, you know, I'm going to go with Lakers and Denver. I think that Denver, you know, with Jokic, with Jamal Murray, he's going to be back by then. They have a lot of talent. I think Porter Jr. takes the next step in his development to being a really good player in the NBA. So give me the Lakers and the Nuggets. And as far as the winner is concerned, I'm going to go with Lakers in six over Denver. I think Lakers in six, and I think both Eastern Conference Finals and Western Conference Finals will both finish in six games. And we're going to get a Lakers. For me, it's going to be Lakers-Bucks in the NBA Finals.
I could see that being my scenario. I could see it being Nets and Lakers in the 2021-22 NBA Finals. And I have the Lakers in seven, maybe six, maybe five. But it depends on where the team is at. And my pick for NBA Finals MVP, I would give it to Anthony Davis or Russell Westbrook. You know, I'm not the biggest fan of LeBron James as a person because he's such a crybaby, always whining and complaining at the referees. I don't like that because I know he does that because he gets hacked in the basket and expresses his displeasure to the referees because that should have been called a foul. I get that, but he just yaps too much, but he's an NBA Finals MVP for a reason. I pick LeBron James to be the NBA Finals MVP.
So for me, I got Lakers and Bucks. You got Lakers and Nets. For my prediction, I'm going to go with the Lakers in a hotly contested seven-game series over the Milwaukee Bucks. I think this is going to be back and forth. It's going to be a fantastic series. You know, the Lakers, I just think the big three outweighs Milwaukee's big three. You know, no disrespect to Giannis, Holiday, and also Middleton. But when you compare big threes, LeBron James, Giannis, you could make an argument either way. I think, you know, it's a pickup. It's a 50-50 pickup. Anthony Davis versus Chris Middleton, there's no doubt you're giving it to Anthony Davis. Anthony Davis, when healthy and when he's up to par, up to his true form, he is a top five player in all of basketball. There's no doubt about that. So Anthony Davis over Middleton. Russell Westbrook, Drew Holiday, you can make that argument also regarding either one. But I just think for me, it's going to come down to who are the Bucks going to put in the paint to stop AD? Because, yes, you do have Giannis. But let's face it, guys. Anthony Davis is not going to be the four in that series against the Bucks. He's going to be the five. Are you really going to try to have Brook Lopez stop a healthy Anthony Davis in the NBA Finals? I don't think so. I think Anthony Davis will walk right over Brook Lopez in that NBA Finals series. I think LeBron versus Giannis. I mean, Loro, get your popcorn, get your soda. Sign me up for that, because that's going to be a great matchup. But it's going to be, I think, Anthony Davis' redemption year, Anthony Davis' revenge year, and I think AD has a monster series. And I think AD, for me, wins not just NBA MVP, but he will win Finals MVP as well.
Yeah, the reason I pick LeBron James winning NBA Finals MVP is because I want each Laker to get an award this year. Russell Westbrook for NBA MVP and Anthony Davis for Defensive Player of the Year. I want the Big Three to win something. I want the Laker Big Three to actually win something. That's why I have LeBron James winning the NBA Finals MVP. I can't wait for this season tomorrow to start. I think that this year and all years, with the COVID year that kind of shortened the 2019-2020 season, having a shortened 72-game season, which was kind of okay, I really think that having a full NBA season again is just a sign of back to normalcy. But also, messing around, why would you predict that, man? Come on!
I'm guessing Mess Around Dave went into a time machine and transported himself to 1997. Because, are you serious?
It's not the 90s anymore, Mess Around!
Look, those two teams are going to be good. But I don't know if they're going to be that good to go to the NBA Finals. Much less, did you get the Bulls? Wow, the Bulls are winning it. Wow. That's crazy, man. That's crazy.
All right. Now, folks, with that being said, let's move on to – let's talk some football here to kind of conclude the show here. So, anyways, folks, let's talk about the Bills-Titans Monday Night Football recap and reaction. So, I was watching the highlights before we came on the air, and I was kind of watching the first half and how it all went. Derrick Henry, I wish I had him on my fantasy team. Is that that dude is a beast. I love that kid. I love Derrick Henry. I love players that come from the University of Alabama. Derrick Henry comes from that neck of the woods. And, man, he is the best running back in the NFL right now. He ran for 76 yards. And even though age doesn't really matter on Derrick Henry, some running backs can go until their age 36 or age 38 season. But I got to tell you, folks, this, Derrick Henry is my favorite running back in the NFL right now. I like the Titans because of Mike Vrabel, but I'm also a really, really big Derrick Henry fan. And also for the Bills, they played a fantastic football game as usual. And I talked about it off air when I saw the play when Josh Allen when the Bills went for it on 4th-and-1 in the red zone. I did not like that decision at all by Sean McDermott. And if I were Sean McDermott in that spot, I would send Tyler Bass out there, get the 3 points, and get this game into overtime. I would have wanted to see that. But here we go. That was a clueless decision right there.
Roro, I had Derrick Henry on my fantasy team, and I made a great, great comeback against one of our fellow co-hosts on this network, Trevor Williams, in our Coast to Colts MI6 Fantasy Football League. I was playing him. I was down by 30 fantasy points entering today. That's a lot to overcome. And Derrick Henry, for me to overcome it, would have had to have a out of this world type of performance. And he did. He had like 20 carries for like 150 something yards. And he had 3 touchdowns. I mean, he was phenomenal. He was running wild all over the Bills defense all night long. They just could not stop him whatsoever. And, you know, it was a great game. The Bills couldn't stop the Titans. The Titans could not stop the Bills. It was a fantastic back and forth type of game. But it came down to what we were talking about with Brian Flores yesterday on the extra point. Over-aggressiveness. In that situation, you're down 3 points. It's 4th and 1. I know the Titans haven't stopped you all night, but you gotta humble yourself and go for the field goal. It doesn't matter if you only need 1 yard, because there's a big chance that he doesn't get it, because the Titans know that on 4th and 1 from the 3-yard line, it's either a running back up the – it's either a run up the middle with the running back, or it's a quarterback sneak. They knew that it was that. You're not going to throw it on 4th and 1, obviously, because if you throw it and you don't complete the pass, everybody's going to label you as an idiot. So it's either going to be a run up the middle with the running back, or it's going to be a run up the middle quarterback sneak with Josh Allen. And so they were ready for it. That's why you don't go for it in that situation. You take the points 100% of the time. I don't know what Sean McDermott was thinking in that situation. That was a really stupid, over-aggressive move by Sean McDermott. He should have taken the field goal. I don't understand why he didn't. It just boggles my mind, because I know that pretty much every coach out there in the NFL would have taken the 3 points instead of trying to get that 1 yard and go into overtime and take your chances in overtime. Because in overtime, Lonro, it starts all over again. No, it is tie game. There's nobody ahead. You might as well take your chances in overtime. And I think the Bills would have had a great chance of winning the game if they had taken it to overtime instead of that play call that they did, going for it on 4th and 1 from the 3 instead of kicking the field goal.
Honestly, Isaiah, when you talk about the Bills, I felt like that this game in particular, that could have been their first loss of the season. I felt like that losing to Pittsburgh was not good for the Bills. I felt like that the Bills would have been undefeated the start of the season undefeated because of how good this team is. As a Patriots fan myself, I hate to see the Bills take over first place, but hey, it's fun to see the passing of the torch in the AFCs in that division, because the division's not good right now. It was supposed to be a really, really good division. But, you know, the Bills showed that they are the team to beat in the AFC East. But not only that, they're a team that really is going to challenge the Kansas City Chiefs and the Cleveland Browns in that top spot in the AFC.
They do. They are going to be a great team, and they're going to be a team that really challenges the Chiefs and the Browns. But if you're a Bills fan right now, you need to be a little bit worried about the defense, because the offense is going to be great. Josh Allen is a fantastic quarterback. The wide receivers with Diggs, Singletary, they're going to be fine. They're going to be great. But it's about the defense. You know, you can't be giving up 34 points in any NFL game if you want to expect to win that game. So, and they did it against the Titans. The Titans just ran all over them. I know Derrick Henry is a beast, but you made him look like nobody in the NFL could stop him. And he's not on that level where nobody in the NFL could stop him running like 20 carries for 150 plus yards and 3 touchdowns. He was averaging, I believe, like 7 yards a carry. Like, I don't care who you play. You can't do that against any NFL team, or else you will lose. So they got to shore that run defense up, Loro.
They sure have to. I mean, I felt like that their defense was off to a great start, because Gregory Owusu was the guy who was going to help in that area. I think that, like you said, they have a really, really good secondary. But I really think that their defense has got to play better than that. They have a bye week this upcoming week. So I really think that this is going to be a good time for the Bills to regroup this defense, get this defense to play better football. They have the Dolphins in 2 weeks. And can we say that that's a guaranteed win for the Bills? With Tua coming back, I'm still really high on Tua Tagovailoa as the Dolphins franchise quarterback, even though that he got hurt and all that. I really think that him having a fully healthy season would really, really benefit the Miami Dolphins. So save that topic for another day here. So now let's talk about LSU. They're going to be parting ways with Ed Orgeron at the end of the season. I felt like that in this move in particular, you should have not done that. Ed Orgeron is the right man to lead the LSU Tigers into the future. He's from the Louisiana area. He led them to a championship. This team is rebuilding right now. They're not really good since that special season that they have in 2019. But I really think that firing Ed Orgeron, I think that's a mistake, and I think it's going to come down to haunt them. But, hey, since USC has an opening, maybe he could be back at USC and say, go Trojans. But I really think that Ed Orgeron is a good coach. But is he right for LSU? He has a really, really fun personality. I love his voice, and he always says, go Tigers, at each and every interview that he gets interviewed from. I think that makes me laugh. I always want to record it on my phone when I watch LSU play.
Loro, I got to respectfully disagree with you. I think this was the right move for LSU. Just because when you look at LSU is like Ohio State. They're like Alabama. They're like USC when it was during their glory days with Pete Carroll. Florida during the Urban Meyer era. They're like one of the biggest brands in all of college football. And when you look at the biggest brands in all of college football, they expect you to win on a consistent year in and year out basis. And when you lose, like, it's not fun. It's not fun when you're the head coach of that football team. You can go like 8-4 in a season, and that's going to feel like, with that fan base at LSU and with you in the SEC, with how big LSU's brand is, 8-4 feels like you had a losing record down there in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. And when you look at Ed Orgeron, Loro, I'll give you some stats. Ed Orgeron, as the head coach of LSU, ever since he won the national title 2 years ago, in two seasons at LSU after that, he's 8-9. And when you're 8-9 at LSU, that just won't cut it at a big program like that. I think Ed Orgeron's a good coach, but I think that he needs to go to a program that is like a middle-tier program that would fit him, like a Washington State. I mean, we'll talk about that later, but Washington State just opened. And I think he will be a perfect fit because their expectations is not that high where they're seeking championships year in and year out. And plus, they need a new voice. You know, the players reportedly quit on him. Bruce Feldman had an article. You can read it on SI.com. But the players quit on him. The coaches don't want to coach for him anymore. It just seemed like things were getting stale and they needed a new voice. So I'm not surprised by this move. I knew it was coming. I just think that Scott Woodward, their athletic director, who was the athletic director at Texas A&M, he wants to swing for the fences. You look at what he did at A&M, luring Jimbo Fisher, giving him a massive contract. What he did at Washington, luring Chris Peterson from Boise State, a guy that everybody never thought he was ever going to leave Boise State. He gets him to come to Washington. He wants a big name. And there's already reports that they want to go after Jimbo Fisher, who Scott Woodward worked with at Texas A&M. There's also talk that the athletic director, Loro, believe it or not, has already contacted Dabo Sweeney's agent.
Oh my God.
They're swinging big. They're swinging for the fences.
I don't want Dabo Sweeney to leave Clemson. If Dabo Sweeney goes to LSU, he's going to have a rivalry with Nick Saban.
Exactly. There's going to be Nick Saban and Dabo Sweeney and Nick Saban or Dabo Sweeney and Jimbo Fisher. But expect a really big name at LSU because that athletic director, he's already calling Dabo Sweeney. He even called Kirby Smart, I believe, to see if he would leave Georgia. He wants
Kirby Smart's not leaving Georgia. Jimbo Fisher's not leaving A&M. I think they're building really good programs there. I just don't want to see Dabo Sweeney leave Clemson. I still think Clemson has a really talented football team, and he's done a really good job coaching Clemson.
Yeah, I think he's done a great, great job coaching Clemson. But this athletic director, Scott Woodward, wants to swing big. So expect a big name down there in LSU.
If they get Dabo Sweeney, then you're going to see a rivalry between him and Nick Saban go head-to-head when LSU and Alabama play. You know I'm the biggest Alabama fan out there because of Bill Belichick being friends with Nick Saban, and I love any player that comes out of that school to the NFL. Yeah.
Hey, and if you know I picked Georgia to win the national championship, and I even sang Glory, Glory to Georgia on one of our programs, if Kirby Smart leaves Georgia – You know how Stephen A. Smith says Aaron Rodgers is a bad, bad man? Well, I'm going to be a sad, sad man if that happens.
That's not going to happen. I don't think Kirby Smart's leaving Georgia. I think that Scott Woodward, the athletic director, he's the current athletic director at LSU right now.
Yes, he is. He's the current athletic director at LSU.
So he wants to swing big. He could go with Chris Peterson. I wouldn't mind that, or maybe he could just look into the NFL and see which coordinator would he want.
Or Bob Stoops. You know, Bob Stoops is retired, but he's a big name.
I think he would lure Bob Stoops out of retirement.
Yeah, I think that could happen for sure.
Because I don't want to see Dabo leave his Clemson Tigers.
I mean, I'll say this before we go to the final topic of tonight's show, and that is the Rolovich thing. But I think that Dabo going to LSU is far more likely to happen than Kirby Smart, because there's no way Kirby Smart's already coaching an SEC program. You're not gonna leave your alma mater in Georgia to go to another SEC program. If Kirby's gonna leave Georgia, it's to go to the NFL.
Yeah, I don't see Kirby Smart even going to the NFL as well. So, also, folks, the Washington State Cougars have fired head coach Nick Rolovich after he refuses to get the COVID-19 vaccine. My thoughts on this is, like, why would you refuse that? I've had my shot, and COVID-19 vaccines are very safe. They're effective. It really helps with your long-term health in stopping COVID-19 and finding a solution to end with it. But as of today, we are living through COVID-19. So it might be the right move, but I think Washington State, you don't expect a lot from this program.
Yeah, I think, Loro, when this came down, I was not surprised at all. In fact, I was expecting this to come down for the last several months now, because what happened was Washington's governor, Governor Inslee, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but Governor Inslee, he issued a mandate for the state of Washington that all state employees have to get vaccinated or else they're going to get fired. And Nick Rolovich, for the past, I believe, like a couple months, have been refusing to get vaccinated. So today was the day that the mandate kicked in for all state employees to get vaccinated, and Rolovich still refused to get vaccinated. So that means he can't work at Washington State. So he can't work, and, you know, he's going to be terminated. That's what happened today. I'm not surprised by it. I'm surprised that Rolovich would give up $3 million per year in his contract. I think he's getting paid for the next 4 years, but he's going to give all that up and probably his last shot or his chance of being a head coach up just because he doesn't want to get the shot. It doesn't make any sense to me why he would do that. I don't understand it. But, you know, I've heard a lot of people say on social media that, you know, they're grouping him with what John Gruden did in the Urban Meyer situation. Listen, folks, what Rolovich did is not nearly as bad as what Gruden did or what Urban Meyer did. Don't put him in that group. He just decided not to take the shot. That's it. He didn't, you know, say any bad stuff about black people or anything like that. He didn't do any of that stuff. So do not put him in that group with Gruden or even with Urban Meyer. But Loro, I'll say this before I hand the floor back to you, and that is, if I'm Nick Rolovich, you're not getting another head coaching gig after what happened with Washington State. Or you probably will get one, but it's going to be a long time until you get one. I think Nick Rolovich, Loro, if you look at his offenses, they have traditionally led the conferences that he's been a part of. Do not be shocked if Nick Rolovich goes to the NFL as an offensive analyst or as an offensive coordinator, because when you look at the NFL, they're running a lot more college offensive concepts. Look what Cliff Kingsbury is doing in Arizona, running, I believe, the air raid. You know, San Francisco, they want to incorporate some of that air raid, run and shoot type of stuff that they're running in college to keep pace with the Chiefs and the other teams that are running it, like Arizona and the Rams. So do not be shocked if Rolovich goes to the NFL, because he's a really good offensive mind and a really good offensive play caller. He'll be a good fit for the Bears. I think he will do a better job, not as a head coach, but as a play caller for the Bears. I mean, he'll be better than Matt Nagy. But me personally, and I'm being biased here, because I'm a huge 49ers fan, and I grew up in Hawaii, and Rolovich was my head coach with the Rainbow Warriors. I want him in San Francisco, Laurel. I want Rolovich in San Francisco, not as a head coach, but maybe on that staff, because I think he could provide really good stuff for the offense for the 49ers.
He sure can. But before we go to final thoughts, let's talk about game three of the ALCS between the Houston Astros and the Boston Red Sox. I was calling that game. Man, the Red Sox look like that they have this series under control. Could this series end in five?
Lolo, the Red Sox are going to win this series. It's just a matter of time. I think the Houston Astros just don't have a shot because they have a great lineup, but their pitching won't be able to keep them in any games. Like we've seen for the first two games of this series, the Red Sox bats are coming alive. They are red hot right now. And the Astros, they're pitching. Their bullpen, they're starting pitching. That was the main concern for me going into the playoffs was, how is the starting rotation going to hold up without Zach Greinke? How is the bullpen going to hold up? Because they really don't have any, like, they don't, outside of Presley, they don't really have quality arms in that bullpen that you can really rely on. Like Brooks Raley, Garcia, Matt Tonn, Blake Taylor, Andre Scrub. You can't really rely on those guys. They're really inconsistent. I've watched them so many times against my Oakland Athletics, so I know what I'm talking about. They don't have a great bullpen. They don't even have a good bullpen. They don't have a good bullpen. They don't have a good starting rotation. And you can't win in baseball without good pitching. Not great pitching, without good pitching. You need good, competent pitching to win in the postseason.
Oh, you're absolutely right. I think like that when I watch baseball. I love good pitching. I love elite pitching that you can go deep into games. You have a bit, your offense puts up a big, big lead, and that your starting pitcher can go deep and even further into a game. That's what I really believe in when I watch baseball. And the Astros don't have that. McCullers is hurt. That's a huge concern for the Astros. For the Red Sox, I really think that their starting pitching is somewhat good, and I also think that their bullpen is kind of iffy. So I think that if the Dodgers and the Red Sox play in the World Series, then I really think that the Dodgers can find a way to get to their bullpen. Let's talk about the NLCS. So the Dodgers are down 2-0 in the series. And like we talked about off air, they have to win all three games in LA so that they have a chance to win in six or maybe seven. I still expect the Dodgers to win this series over the Braves. I am not in panic mode on them just yet, despite being down 0-2. It is a seven-game series, not a best-of-five series. I think the Dodgers can repeat history with the Braves.
I think they could, but I think it's going to be really tough if you go down 3-1 again, because you went down 3-1 in a neutral environment, so you could definitely go back and win. But now there's no neutral environment. You're playing either at your home or you're playing at the opponent's home. So you have to take the next two games in LA. You absolutely have to. If you don't, then it's going to be really tough going back to Atlanta for the next couple of games.
It is. And then you talk about these two walk-offs. The Braves just got luckier. I don't think the Braves are going to win this series because of all this. They need to have deep pitching. You got Charlie Morton on the mound tomorrow against Walker Buehler. That is going to be a great pitching matchup, by the way. But I think that the Dodgers need to get to Charlie Morton early to have a chance to win this game. They got to Ian Anderson early. But what I'm saying is that I really think that for the Dodgers tomorrow, you got to get to an early lead. You got to have a big enough lead to hold on. The bullpen wasn't good these first two games, but I know that this Dodgers bullpen has been fantastic throughout this postseason so far.
They've been, but the pitching, they gotta win the next two games. Dave Roberts, you gotta do whatever you can to help your ball club win the next two games. The next two games, in my opinion, is going to be two of the biggest games that the Dodgers have played in the last like 5 years, because it's huge. You can't go down 3-1 going back to Atlanta. Heck, you can't even go down 3-0 going into games four and five and six. So you gotta win the next two games. It is very, very big for the Dodgers to win the next two games.
This Dodgers team's too good to not make it to the World Series with the roster that they have. I really think they can, but if they don't make the World Series, it would be because of injuries, not having Max Muncy in your lineup. That is a huge blow to the Dodgers. And they got to make sure that they get him healthy next season if the Dodgers were to get eliminated. I'm not thinking negative about this. I'm not trying to make excuses. It's because I think that the Dodgers are missing some of their key pieces. I know that they have the depth to do it. Like, losing Clayton Kershaw for the entire playoffs is a huge, huge blow for the Dodgers. I expect him to be back with the Dodgers next season. And if Max Muncy can't come back for this playoff round, like, say if the Dodgers get eliminated, then I really think that it would be beneficial for the Dodgers to get him healthy and then set up for a deeper run next season. If you have any thoughts on that.
No, I completely agree with you. I think that for the Dodgers, tomorrow is going to be the deciding factor to see if Max Muncy is going to play again. Because if you're going down 3-0 low roll, I mean, the only team that's come back from 3-0 and actually won it was the Boston Red Sox of 2004. It's really, really, really hard to come back from 3-0. So they got to win tomorrow's game.
It's must. You got to. You got the right man to do it in Walker Buehler on the mound. All right, folks. It has been a great show. Looking forward to this upcoming NBA season. And, folks, it's time to give out our final thoughts. Isaiah, it's been a great show. I mean, we didn't have a show Friday, but I can't wait to talk about what's in store on Friday. Well, we could recap the ALCS on Friday if the Red Sox finish this series in five, or if the Braves finish this in five. We could have something to talk about then. So what is your final thoughts for the night?
Well, before I get into my final thoughts, you know, I just want to take the time to thank our fans, Mess Around Dave, for, you know, tuning in and commenting, Jared Peterson, Christy Wilson. I know we didn't really have like that many comments as usual that we always have because we didn't stream on Facebook tonight. We only streamed on YouTube and also on Periscope. But, you know, thanks again to the fans, man. They found a way to tune into our show and to still comment on a really high level. So really appreciate you guys for being dedicated and tuning into our show tonight. Really appreciate you. But, Loro, I'm the same like you. I'm so, so ecstatic. I'm so stoked for the NBA season. I can't wait for Lakers and Warriors tomorrow, the debut of the big three with LeBron, Westbrook, and Anthony Davis. It's going to be an amazing game. I can't wait for that. I think that game will be going down to the wire. It's going to be a great first game to tip off the NBA season. I'm just looking forward to like the entire and like the first week of the NBA season. I know that there's going to be a lot of great stuff happening in the NBA, and I can't wait for it. It's going to be a great NBA season. And, you know, we're going to definitely look back on this program, tonight's program. We're going to look back after the season because I'm pretty sure like a lot of our predictions will be wrong because it's always like that, you know, Loro. It's always like you make predictions before the season and then you end up looking like you look like really, really dumb because your predictions are either out of whack or some teams don't perform to their standards or some teams get bitten by the injury bug. And you're just looking like, wow, I really, really picked this team to make the playoffs and they're now one of the worst teams in the NBA. So looking forward to this NBA season.
Yes, absolutely. And my other final thought is, why would Billy Bean withdraw his name from the Mets job? Oh my God.
It's terrible, man. I really wanted Bean to leave, not because he's not good, but because I just want a new voice in the A's organization. And I want a new direction in the A's organization. And with him staying, it's just gonna be more of the same for the Oakland A's.
Small ball, being cheap, not raising payroll. I just think the A's, that system has really worked, but if in order to win the World Series, you got to raise up the money, up the price tag.
Exactly. And the A's just don't do that. It's sickening.
It is. Moneyball, you got to end that Moneyball era because the Rays use it. But I think that when they're fully healthy, I think the Rays can really make a run. But obviously without Tyler Glasnow, it was definitely a big, big blow there. So anyways, folks, that's going to do it for Wild Sports Talk. Thank you for tuning in to our special show, talking about the NBA, talking some football. And in just about 24 hours, we got NBA basketball back. And I'll be calling the Lakers-Warriors game tomorrow on ColorCast. You don't want to miss that. But I'm doing the Dodger game first on ColorCast. against the Braves. As we talked about, it is a must-win for the Dodgers, and I really think that they could find a way to win this game. And if they don't win Game 3, then the series could definitely be over in 4 or maybe 5. So that's it. Loro signing off for now. For Isaiah Leong, the Asian Skip Bayless, our producer, Stephen Wang, if you're watching, thank you for producing this awesome show. We can't wait to see where this goes. Loro signing off for now. And folks, the goal is to reach over 1 million listens before the end of the year so that we can have another show like this. So have a great rest of your night. And the next Wild Sports Talk show will be on Friday. And then don't forget to tune into the Night Shift on Thursday. Have a great night, everyone.
Guitar.